Hi, I'm Dan Lakin, and welcome to another episode of Around the World in 80 Drinks. Thanks for watching. This week I'm going to be making a bee's knees cocktail. It's super easy. We're also going to be speaking to a great bartender in Bali, Indonesia. Her name is Raviella, and just stay tuned in to see that. It's fantastic to see what's happening over there at this time of year. Completely different weather to what we've got in the UK. I am going to fire away with this bee's knees cocktail. Like I say, super easy. Any of you who have ever done any of my masterclasses or watched the early shows will know that I start bartenders off in training with fizz and sours. They're easy cocktails, and once you learn those, you know so many drinks. And that's where this drink started. It was made by originally a bartender, forgive me my pronunciation of his last name, Frank Mier. He was a bartender in the Ritz in Paris. This is a prohibition drink, so it's 1920s. And the reason it's sort of it's a spin-off of the sour and fizz is the way it starts off. So you start it with some lemon. So with a shot of lemon, we're gonna use a whole lemon. So that equates to about 25 mil. So I'm gonna just squeeze half of that in there, half the lemon. And then I'm going to squeeze the other half in as well. So a whole fresh lemon equates to one shot, thereabouts. It's about 25, 30 mil. And there we have it, that's that done. So that's the same as the sour. The sour has a whole shot of souring, i.e. lemon. This is where it differs slightly. The sweet we're using is honey. Let me just grab my bar spoon. The sweet we're using is honey. And we're going to use a similar quantity that we would if it was a bar spoon of sugar. So we're going to use a bar spoon of honey. Actually, we're going to use 2 bar spoons of honey. So when we are using a fresh sugar, whether it's white or brown, 2 bar spoons or 2 teaspoons of sugar equates to about half a shot of sugar syrup. So bartenders use gum or sugar syrup or whatever syrup it is in the cocktail to balance out the sour. So the sugar to sour ratio should be 1 of the sour to half of the sugar. That's the ratio. So different cocktails might use different sours, different sugars, but as long as you get that sort of ratio, then you're going to end up with a balanced drink. So like I say, this is the base of the bee's knees. Same base apart from where you as a sour, apart from we're using honey and we're not using the sugar. So that should be balanced out. It shouldn't be too sweet, it shouldn't be too sour. We're going to put a large measure of gin in. This is Gordon's. With it being predominantly a gin drink, I mean, what I mean by that is the main ingredient is gin. You want to try and use the best gin you can, or the gin that you like like most. Gordon's, I find, is the ginniest gin out there. It's what I call an airplane gin. When you go up on an airplane, you want to be able to taste the gin. Your taste buds change on an airplane. So I always choose, Gordon's. If you choose something like Bombay isn't the most ginny gin out there. It was originally created to get the vodka drinkers off vodka and onto gin. That's why it's a fancy blue bottle. And that's why it's not really, really ginny. When I say ginny, it's not really, really juniper. It hasn't got that really overpowering taste. It's a little bit of spice there, but basically it's somewhere between a vodka and a gin, in my opinion. It hasn't got loads of juniper in there. It's got loads of botanicals in there, but it hasn't got loads of flavour. So you want to use whatever gin that you like, that you want to drink straight almost. Is it something like Bombay? Is it something like Gordon's or Bulldog or Portobello Road or whatever it may be, however you like your gins, maybe Hendrix, or something with some flavour. Choose it, stick in a large measure in here, and you're going to create a fantastic drink. You might notice that I've just put some ice cubes in my glass to start cooling down that. I'm just going to get rid of that. At the end of the day, when you pour something into a martini glass, it's not going to have ice when you serve it, so you want to make sure the glass is already cold. You want to make sure the drink's really cold when you stick it in there, and that way, if it's all cold when it goes in and you're not serving it with ice, you're still going to get a cold drink for a certain amount of time, 5-10 minutes maybe. What they say is if the condensation line starts to drop below the level of your drink, you're not drinking it quick enough. So remember that. Right, okay, let's get some ice in there. Loads of ice. You want to be able to blend the ingredients, drive through some air through the drink, and obviously cool it and not dilute it too much. So, shake. So anything into a martini glass, you do really want a double strain. I don't have a double strainer at home. This is what it's about, it's home bartending. All I've got is a single strainer. And when I say single strainer, I've got this Hawthorne, it will go on the top, I'll pour it into my martini glass. The double strain is something like a sieve, a tea strainer, something along those lines. You want to get all the shards out, all the shards of ice, and any fruit that's left. So you want it to be clear as possible. And it's as simple as that. That's the bee's knees. We just need to garnish it. Garnish it with something that's going to complement the drink, complement it through aesthetics, so the looks of it, complement through flavor, so any flavor that comes off the garnish is going to be on the drink, and the smell of it. Anything that complements the drink you want on the edge of your glass, basically. And mine's gonna be a little lemon rind hung on the side of the glass, looking not too dissimilar from a bee. And there we have it, a bee's knees. Simple as that. Cheers. Delicious. It's basically a sour, it's basically a gin sour, but we've used honey instead of sugar. Easy, really easy. Right, okay, let's roll straight to our VT. Like I say, she's in Bali. She's in a hotel bar that's on the beachfront. So let's fire away. Raviella, thanks a lot for coming on Around the World in 80 Drinks. How are you doing all the way in Bali?
Hi, we're doing fine in Bali. Like everything's like trying to reopen again.
Yeah.
Yeah, even okay. The border is still closed for foreign customers, but I think it's doing pretty well, like step by step.
Okay, cool. So tell us a bit about yourself. How long have you been bartending for, and whereabouts have you been working?
So I've been bartending for about 5 years, actually. And my first bartending time was in Hard Rock Hotel Bali.
Yeah,
that was the first time I fell in love with bartending, actually.
And I think they have quite good bar training in Hard Rock Hotel, don't they?
Yeah, but actually it's the fun in it, and like the, you know, craziness working behind the bar. It's what makes me like really like working behind the bar.
Yeah. And I know that sort of bar training is quite American. It's a different sort of training, I'm guessing, to where you're working now.
It's quite different, because from Hard Rock, after that I went to it's called Blanco Parmandif. That's actually like an Indonesian fine dining.
Okay.
And you know, like from Hard Rock, which is crazy, and then I went to fine dining, which is like formal and stuff. But in those two places, I learned like a lot. Like in Hard Rock, I learned like how you engage with guests, and how you can be like entertainment for your guests. But yeah. in the fine dining, I learned more about like the beauty of mixology, you know, the ingredients, like how fine ingredients make fine results, more like that. Like how ice can affect your cocktail, more like that. And after Blanco, I went to Jungle Fish. That's like a beach club.
Nice.
Actually, I learned a lot there about like leadership and like systems and stuff. And then I just joined this new hotel. Hotel and bar. It's from Opolo Group. Actually, Opolo Group is a chain from Hong Kong, and they have a lot of properties in Australia. And this is the first property in Indonesia.
Amazing. And it's brand new, isn't it, were you saying? It's only been open a few months or weeks?
Yeah, we've been open like 2 weeks ago.
Wow. So they were building it all through COVID, and obviously they've launched it during COVID.
Yeah, so actually the company bought an old hotel here, and
they've okay.
been renovating and constructing since March.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, and we just opened 2 weeks ago. So actually a lot of places in Bali have been closed since March.
Right.
Yeah, but this month, like a lot of places are starting to reopen as well.
Okay, good. And what's the name of the bar that you're in?
The hotel name is Mamaka by Obolo.
Okay.
And, yeah, my outlet's name is Street 32.
Street 32.
Yes.
I did have a look at that briefly on Instagram. Your Sunday nights and your Sunday afternoons look fun there.
Sorry?
Your Sunday nights and the Sunday afternoons look really fun there. Is it beer and bao buns?
We have that event every Sunday. It's like free flow baos and like beers, craft beers, like local craft beers, and like DJs, you know, like to chill on Sunday.
Yeah, amazing. Yeah. Amazing. I really wish we could get involved with that. At the moment in the UK, or at the moment where I am in the UK, we're in something called Tier 3, which is basically like lockdown, so no bars, no restaurants. So it'd be nice to be where you are at the moment.
Yeah, maybe after the lockdown you can come to Bali.
Oh, I'd love to. I'd absolutely love to go to Bali. But what I'll do now is I'll hand over to you to make the drink that you're making. So it's over to you.
So I'm actually making one of our signature here. It's a twist of old fashioned.
Okay.
Yeah. So actually, old fashioned is one of my favorite cocktails, and I really love to twist old fashioned. Okay. So for sugar, I'm using local palm sugar.
Okay.
Now the thing about Bali, what I love, is we like to twist cocktails with local ingredients. And then this is a locally made bitter, dark chocolate bitter. Just give a muddle. So actually the name of the cocktail is Satay Old Fashioned. If you ever heard about satay, that's like a local traditional food.
Yeah,
it's like a skewer with a peanut sauce like that. It's like a signature street food of Indonesia. Okay,
so amazing. That's...
And then, so the bourbon, I'm using bourbon. The bourbon we already do fat wash with peanut butter.
Okay. Thank you.
you? For the garnish as well, I'm using a brandy cherry. So actually it's hard to find like different kind of berries and cherries in Indonesia. So we have to do some kind of creativity to make it different. So this one, we soak it in brandy.
Nice.
Since if you know satay is made with grill, so it has a little bit of smokiness, so I will smoke the cocktail as well with bourbon oak chip.
Old fashioned. Amazing, well done. That I wish I can almost imagine the smell, the smokiness, and the peanut butter. I really would love to try that drink. Cheers. Yeah,
this is actually my favorite out of all of the menu here.
I'm not surprised. I've got a satay and the peanut butter old fashioned. It does sound amazing. I might try and replicate that at home.
Yeah, you should try. Yeah.
So you've also entered competitions before, or at least one competition, and was it Captain Morgan's?
Yeah, I did join two competitions. The first one is Captain Morgan. It was Captain Mojito competition.
Okay.
Yeah, so basically at that competition we have to like remake Mojito with our signature.
Yeah.
That moment I represent Blanco Pamandif, which was the fine dining. So I made like, it's called espejito, which means like glass looking or mirror. So I made it like with all glass, like thin glass with thin straw. And like I make the mojito very, very clear.
Okay.
I make the mojito very, very clear, and I use like local ingredients, like Balinese long pepper.
Nice. Actually, I'll just say lean down a little bit. I just can't see your face.
Oh, sorry.
That's better. Okay, cool. And also, I know you touched on it a little bit earlier. So your lockdown started in March, and then how long was that for? How long were your bars and restaurants closed for from March?
A lot of places, like actually most of the places in Bali and Indonesia were closed since March until August, September.
Wow.
Some places are now permanently closed, and some outlets that can reopen, they start to reopen. But like at some area, like for example in Ubud, where I was working, is very quiet there. Like it's so hard to open a business. So a lot of places they chose to close down because it's just the best decision.
Yeah. So it's not the government saying that places need to close. It's because there's no tourism and there's no customers.
About government, actually, it's more like depending on the area. Based on the province itself.
Okay.
In some province, the
oh, I think the sound's gone. I think the sound's gone there. Oh no, we seem to have lost we seem to have lost the sound. We'll take a pause and we'll try and get it back on. We've managed to sort out the technical difficulties, and so we have you back. So yeah, you were talking about individual areas being closed and a lot of places being really quiet. I'm assuming obviously you've got is it locals coming to your place?
Yeah, so actually, like, based on the province, in some area that has high numbers of COVID, they have like this kind of not completely locked down, but yeah, restaurants are they have to close. Maybe for deliveries, it's fine, but no dine-in.
Right.
Yeah. But in Bali, actually, most of the places close down because they don't have revenue, not because of the government, you know.
Yeah. Okay. And okay.
In Bali, we kind of really rely on the tourism that much. So once the tourism like closed down, we struggled a lot. Like a lot of places, like we. Yeah, they close down. They don't even survive.
Wow. Okay.
So, about the local, it's a lot of places are doing adaptation. They're adapting because we have to make revenue. So, like a lot of places now make like some kind of promos, which target more to locals. So local market, yeah.
Okay. Okay. I've just heard in the background a Christmas song come on there. Absolutely amazing. So you guys have started celebrating Christmas early like us.
Yeah, you know, usually in, I don't know in other places, but in Indonesia, usually when we enter December, Christmas songs are already everywhere.
And so I've never been to Bali, but it's south of the equator, isn't it? So is it summer there now, or is it winter?
We actually don't have four seasons.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so we only have hot and rainy.
Oh, okay, right. So is it hot today or rainy?
Now it's starting to enter rainy season.
Okay, right, okay.
Yeah, but the thing is, even though it's rainy, it's still hot in here.
Right, okay. It's so strange speaking to bartenders across the world, and I forget about the weather. And as a Brit, that's all we usually talk about, the weather. But I always forget to ask.
Is it winter there?
Yeah, it's winter here. So at the moment, the temperature range is somewhere between maybe 5 and 12 degrees Celsius.
Oh wow!
So yeah, it's quite cold. Sometimes it's sunny but cold. Sometimes it's wet and windy.
Wow.
But it's nice to hear, you know, traffic in the background and music in your bar and a bit of hustle and bustle. It's nice to hear that there's things going on where you are.
Yeah, because actually our outlet is like by the road, which is across the beach. Let me show you.
Okay.
Is it working?
That's there we
the
go.
Beach over there.
Oh wow.
Yeah.
Oh, I love it.
And it's 6 p.m. now, so it's about to sunset here.
Okay. Okay, cool. Yeah, it's 10 a.m. here. So it's a bit too early for a smoky old fashioned, but but enjoy it anyway. And I think we've nearly come to our 20 minute session time, really, but I just want to thank you so much for coming on Around the World in 80 Drinks. Ladies and gentlemen, it's Raviella.
Thank you so much for having me.
Absolute pleasure, thank you.
Another great bartender on Around the World in 80 Drinks. I love chatting to people across the world. In fact, you probably notice a little addition in the background. It's my scratch map. And every time I speak to a country, I scratch off a part of it. And when I say country, I haven't scratched off the whole of the states. I'm doing each state one by one. So I committed to around the world in 80 drinks. I'm going to try and stick to 80 countries. And by the time I've scratched 80 countries off that, who knows where I'll go next. On that note, I'm sending these stickers across the globe. They've ended up, well, I mean, God knows where. I've sent loads across the world over the past week. So if anybody wants one, drop us a PM. I'll PM you back asking for your address and we'll send it anywhere you want. So you can stick it somewhere awesome and share it on social. That's all we're asking for. So that's it really. Until next week when we're speaking to another bartender somewhere on this planet. So stay tuned in. Please subscribe to the YouTube channel. I'm Dan Lakin. This is a Bee's Knees. And thanks for watching Around the World in 80 Drinks.